Nintendo has officially discontinued the 3DS, ending its 9-year run. At first, that news may sound just like any other console life coming to a close, but I'd argue that while yes, it is technically just that, it's also the end of Nintendo's most ambitious era. Nintendo's always been one for innovation. The D-pad on the NES, the joystick on the N64, the Rumble Pak also on the N64. No matter how minor it was, they were always the first to build a path for something that would become an industry standard. But that's the thing, none of their major innovations were too out there. More or less, these were natural progressions for the industry. And when they do make something that does go too far out there, it usually doesn't last long. The Power Pad, the Super Scope, Rob the Robot, the Zapper, these accessories simply were a bit too ahead of the curve, or their appeal was just too limited. But of course, the one time they tried to base an entire console around some ginormous innovation was the Virtual Boy. The amount of resources poured into the Virtual Boy only for it to flop as hard as it did, it was a big reminder to Nintendo to just stay on track and make sure their console's hardware can stack up against their competitions. Sure, they added analog triggers to the GameCube to separate themselves a little bit, but they didn't separate themselves too much. By the 6th generation, everything seemed to be kind of set in stone, because at that point you've watched Nintendo make the expected jump in hardware alongside their competition for 3 generations in a row now, and during that entire time, you've had a Game Boy in your pocket. It sounds ludicrous now, but there was a point in time where it was impossible to imagine the name Game Boy ever going away. Since 1989, it's been there to offer fans a method to play some of their favorite Nintendo franchises on the go. But between both your GameCube and your Game Boy Advance, all you were really doing was pushing buttons. And again, that's been a consistency since 1989. So what reason did we have to believe that the next generation would be any different? E3 2004, Reggie comes out on stage, pulls a sleek little machine out from under his coat, and goes,
"This is Nintendo DS."
At the time, I wondered, why isn't it the Game Boy DS? But now I realize, this was the very start of a completely new kind of Nintendo. A Nintendo that would take us where no other gaming company ever could. To start, unlike any Game Boy, it had powerful enough hardware to run fully 3D games, which was honestly expected at this point. But of course, most importantly, it had 2 screens, with one of them being a touchscreen. For reference, the previous best piece of touchscreen technology at this point was the Palm PDA. Or the Pixter, if anyone remembers that thing. When the DS released that holiday season, the iPhone was still a whole 3 years away, so Nintendo would be the first company to take an idea as commonplace today as a touchscreen and truly show the potential of what could be done with it. When I got that Metroid Prime Hunters bundle back in the day, playing Prime on something that fits in my pocket using a touchscreen to aim around, it truly felt like a part of the future, the same kind of future we always envisioned in movies. I thought the DS was the most amazing thing ever. But little did I know what was coming next. Nintendo was teasing the next mainline console for quite a while. It was officially revealed at E3 2005 under the name of Nintendo Revolution, but details were kept slim. Tokyo Game Show 2005 was when the remote was revealed, alongside with the fact that it would be motion-based. However, E3 2006 was when we got the biggest boom of information. And most importantly, we didn't just get proof of concept footage, we got real gameplay of real games, alongside people playing the games. And seeing the system's motion controls actually in use really drove home how big of a deal this was going to be. When I originally got my Wii, I got SpongeBob, Creature from the Krusty Krab, and Rayman Raving Rabbids with it. It was the first time I've ever gotten a Nintendo console without a first-party Nintendo title to go along with it. But it didn't matter, because for a period of time, those were the 2 best games I've ever played. There was literally nothing else like the Wii. Waving your arms around, seeing your character mimic your actions, it was so much fun. Not to mention when Mario Galaxy came out, the motion controls were used sparingly throughout the game, yeah, but using the pointer to grab star bits as you're jumping about, it felt like a third level of control that couldn't be done with anything else. And even outside of the games themselves, there were so many features such as the Weather Channel and the Check Me Out Channel, but of course the most notable of them was the Mii Maker. I couldn't even imagine how many hours I've spent just sitting there making Miis. It was always going to be a wondrous time, as long as you had a Wiimote in your hand. And unlike Nintendo's aforementioned innovations like the D-pad or the joystick, no one was really able to imitate the motion controls that the Wii pulled off. There were attempts like Microsoft's Kinect and Sony's PlayStation Move, but it seemed that no one could get it down quite like Nintendo could. The Xbox 360, the PS3, and even the PSP were there for when you wanted a more standard gaming experience, but the Wii and DS were just perfect companions for each other. Whether you were at home or at the park, this new era of Nintendo magic was always there for you. But like any generation, the question arose, what was next? And this time around, that question was more difficult to answer than ever. I don't think it'd be incorrect to say that the sheer amount of ambition that the Wii and DS had is one of the major reasons for their success, especially since the Wii was barely more powerful than the GameCube, while the other two consoles of that generation made gigantic leaps graphically from the PS2 and Xbox to the PS3 and Xbox 360. It could only be assumed that Nintendo's upcoming home console and upcoming handheld system would once again bring some crazy new idea to the table, but what those ideas would be was unimaginable. It wouldn't be until E3 2010 where we'd finally see the successor to the DS, a no-glasses-required 3D machine with the quite obvious name of the Nintendo 3DS. And even at my young age, I was unimpressed. 3D just didn't seem like the literal game changer that motion controls or touch controls did, being pretty much just a visual magic trick. However, when I finally got one myself, I adored it. I probably used the 3D effects for about 5 minutes, and the system's launch lineup wasn't all too impressive, but the amount of features jam-packed into the thing, backwards compatibility with DS games, and of course the games themselves, made me attached to the thing almost as much as I was attached to the original DS. Personally, a few of my favorites were Link Between Worlds, Mario 3D Land, Mario Kart 7, and not to mention Smash 4, a game that really drove home the power of the system because a portable Smash Brothers was something that we used to only be able to dream of. And again, about those features, while they weren't the most amazing things in the world, I found their inclusion to make the system so much more endearing. Face Raiders, the AR cards, the Miis, the crappy camera, it still had the same remarkable Nintendo aesthetic that the original Wii and DS had, and there was always something coming to the system that would keep you coming back to it. And every time you booted it up, you'd be greeted with that charming assortment of icons on the bottom screen, along with an icon and a little jingle for whatever you had highlighted on the top screen. And again, while the 3D didn't get used as much as motion controls or a touchscreen, it was still an attempt like the Wii or DS to base a system around one big innovation, and more than anything, to make the system feel like the new Nintendo we've come to love. But of course, the complimentary console during this generation was the Wii U. While the 3D of the 3DS ended up being a pretty insignificant part of a much greater system, the Wii U suffered because of how intrusive the system's gimmick was towards the console as a whole, without being practical enough to make up for it. While the DS and Wii delivered entirely different experiences, one based around touching and the other based around motion, the way the Wii U gamepad was implemented made it just feel like a bigger version of the DS. The awful battery life, the fact that you could only have one gamepad connected at a time, and the fact that it still used Wiimotes, all made it feel like the Wii U was trying to do something different just for the sake of doing something different, rather than doing it because it was a good idea. I could go off about the Wii U's failures, but at the end of the day, they tried. It did so many things wrong, but it still tried to retain that level of charm that Nintendo was riding off of, and while the gamepad ended up being more of a negative of the system rather than a plus, they still wanted to do something new and try to change the way we play games. With the death of the 3DS, it feels like this era of Nintendo is just over. Today we have the Switch. Don't get me wrong, I love my Switch, but it seems that in the same way that the Virtual Boy told Nintendo to stay on track, the Wii U told Nintendo to get back to focusing on the hardware. It still has the touchscreen, the pointer, the motion controls, but these feel like the requirements needed for the system to be able to properly run ports rather than an actual selling point. Of course though, it also introduced HD Rumble, which is pretty neat, but most importantly the entire point of the system, the fact that it's a hybrid home console and handheld. You could argue that's just as big or bigger of an innovation than the Wiimote, but it doesn't impact how you play the game, it just changes where you play it. However, I don't think you can argue against the fact that all the soul Nintendo had with them from the beginning of the DS to the end of the 3DS seems to just be missing from the Switch. There's no extra features, no music, the Miis are barely integrated into the system at all, and the menus themselves are as simple to navigate as they are bland. Again, I love my Switch, but I miss being able to enjoy my Nintendo console outside of just playing games. Whether it's screwing around on PictoChat, making Miis, browsing Miiverse, taking photos, or even just appreciating the mesmerizing floating cube of the GameCube menu, all of that is just gone. The same kind of ambitious spirit we saw in the Wii and DS lives on through experiments like Ring Fit Adventure and Nintendo Labo. They certainly still have an itch to scratch, but considering the success of the Switch, it's hard to imagine Nintendo ever ditching the console handheld hybrid concept, but honestly, I'm perfectly fine with that. It's just the end of an era, and I'm hopeful for the games Nintendo has in store. So all we can really do is say goodbye to the 3DS, and thank you to Nintendo for the memories.